How are you now? It's been a little while since I made a video. What can I say? Life gets busy. But today I'm going to talk about cooking in a small space, my minivan, what I've done over the years, different methods I've tried, and maybe it'll give you some ideas. I'm going to rip a little bit on people that cook with fire inside their car, but you do what you want. I'm not judging. I'm just going to show you what I've done and my thoughts on each thing. And we're going to conclude with something I think you're going to find pretty neat for those of you that have a larger capacity electrical system in your vehicle or in your small RV. So when people go out camping, they usually start with some type of a stove if they're doing family type camping, liquid fuel stove. If they're backpackers, they'll have a small butane or maybe even a propane stove. I'm not any different. I have a small camp stove and I've used this in the past. A friend gave it to me. And they work great. They work great outdoors, in my opinion. If I light this up, they all operate about the same way. You have some butane canister, turn it to ignite, you get a flame. This one uses these little propane butane cylinders, and does a pretty good job by itself. I don't like having an open flame in my car, so I've used these outside on a picnic table. When you're stuck in a rainy day or something, or maybe you're living full time in your van, you may want to bring it inside and try cooking. In a van, I think there's probably enough room. In a minivan, I don't know, it's a tight space. And I think a lot of people don't think about how flammable a vehicle is. You may in modern cars have flame retardant materials, but we're all modifying our vans and we're putting stuff in them that's not necessarily flame retardant. So for example, you might have a pillow, a sleeping bag, a foam mattress, and all those things are going to burn really nice if this thing gets out of control. So I prefer not to use that. And at this point, if I'm cooking, I'm going to cook with one of my other systems. I could still carry this and use it on a picnic table, but I just don't see the advantage with my current setup. You'll see later on why I think that. Another disadvantage of this type of stove is at high altitudes, they don't work as efficiently, and if it's cold out, they don't work that well. I've used this when it was 30 degrees, and basically the propane butane cylinder ices up, and so you get a lower flow, and your flame size goes down, and then it takes even longer to cook, especially since it's cold outside. So I'll probably pass this on to somebody else that does more conventional camping and stick with one of my solutions. I turn this off so I don't set myself on fire while I'm doing this video. The other thing I've used in the past is this little ember-lit stove. So this is a backpacking stove. They come in titanium. This one is stainless, if I remember right. Feels like stainless. And the way they work is you pick up some twigs off the ground, combustible materials, stick it into the base, and then you can feed longer sticks into it. And you can get a very hot fire in these. And the nice thing is you don't have to carry fuel with them. Now, you're never going to use this in a van because it's giving off carbon monoxide. It's smoking, big flame. But if you're going to cook outside, I've used one of these. If you decide to use one of these and plan on doing most of your cooking outside, or you want to bring one with you for when you're hiking, I make a suggestion, and that is to carry some wood pellets. You can buy wood pellets for wood pellet stoves at a hardware store, but you can also get the ones that you use on a smoker, on a grill, and those generally come in different wood types like cherry and apple and hickory, and they smell a lot better when they burn. But what's really nice is you get a nice hot fire. They're easy to ignite, carry a supply in your van, and you always have a fuel source without picking around on the ground. So I've used these. And the point of telling you all that is just that I've tried other methods. And so when I give what I think is good advice, but everybody's situation is different, it comes from a position of having used all these things. So I'll move on to the electrical appliances in a minute, but first I want to talk a little bit about my current setup in the van. So currently I have two 100 amp hour lithium iron phosphate batteries and a 1000 watt inverter, and then I have a Renogy DC to DC charge controller that charges off of the vehicle, and it also charges off of my 200 watt solar panel on the roof. That's a lot of power, and people starting out don't necessarily have that much power. So I'm going to go through the different steps of what I did over the years. When I run these tests on the appliances, I'm going to be using power from the van. Hopefully you can see that that's glowing. So right now the inverter's on, running off of the vehicle, not going to pull any fast ones. Everything I do here can be run off of this system, and some of it can be run off a smaller system. All right, so when I first started traveling in the van, I used this immersion heater. I don't mean this model, I mean this exact immersion heater. I've used it for years, and I still use it occasionally. It's a 300-watt coil, and basically it pulls between 280 and 300 watts. I'll do a little test on it in a minute. And it does a good job of heating water. Okay, great. So you have hot water. Well, what can you make with hot water? Well, you can make breakfast. You can make oatmeal. You can cook eggs in a bag. You can use it to make dried soups, ramen, coffee. So it's really nice to, if you're just starting off, to have one of these. What do you need to run it? Well, there's a little bit of inrush current on these, so I suggest people have a 400-watt inverter, which I think is what I had in my original gold minivan when I started off, my gold Odyssey. I just hooked up an inverter and I ran it off of the vehicle. You can run these off of a battery pack, but it depends on the size. You know, just know that it's going to be pulling 300 watts while it's running. If you want to heat up a container about this size, I suggest that you go with some type of a vacuum flask. So whether it's a Yeti cup or whatnot, something that's insulated, I guess is what I'm saying, and something that's metal or glass. I don't like bringing glass if it can be avoided because glass is breakable. So stick with my metal cups. So this, I think, is a Yeti knockoff. But anyway, the reason I say insulated cup is it'll heat your water a lot faster. It'll take about 12 minutes to heat up about 16 ounces of water. So with that, you can make your French press, your pour over or whatever, and have your cup of coffee. The limitation of this is that, let's say I'm making a bowl of oatmeal and I'm also making a cup of coffee. Well, now I have to make my cup of coffee, start sipping on that while I heat up another batch of water. So we'll get into a bigger system in a bit. But if you're just starting off and you have a small inverter, these are the way to go. So when you use one of these, the trick is always put it in water before you plug it in, and then unplug it before you take it out of the water. If you plug this in, it turns on instantly, and if it's in the air, it'll rapidly overheat and fail. If you follow those instructions, in the water, plug it in, when it boils, unplug it, take it out of the water, and then what I do is I generally hang it up, I'll open the front door, hang it on the mirror, just so it can cool off a little bit. So when you're first done, if you set it down, it's still kind of hot, you don't want to melt your carpet or whatever. So I'm going to do a little power test on this to show you what the drawer is, just so you can say, okay, he's telling the truth here. It's, I can run this on my 400 watt inverter. So what I'm going to use is a kilowatt. If you've never seen one of these, it's kil-a-watt. Okay. So kilowatt, and, choose to find parasitic drawers around your house. And I bought it specifically to measure some things that I was doing videos for. And it has a setting on here. I can either select amperage and see how much current it's drawing, or just select watts, which is handy. A watt is a good way to look at it, because when you talk about current draw, and I have to talk about voltage, current times voltage is power, and you're going between 12 volts and 120 volts, it gets confusing. So I'm going to just talk in terms of watts. So let's run a little test here on this kilowatt and this immersion heater. And I'm gonna make sure that I'm unplugged and before I plug this in. And I'll stick that in the water. And then plug everything in from the van. All right, and then there's a little switch on the side. So let me hit that switch and we'll get rolling here. All right, so right now, get this out of the way. I'm going to go to amps. I'm pulling 2.2 amps, so at 120 volts, that's roughly 240 watts. But if I go to the watt setting, I can measure that directly and see that it's pulling 229. Now, this is rated for 300 watts, but over time, they kind of degrade, so they take a little bit longer to heat things up. So for the first method of cooking, the immersion heater, we're pulling 230 watts, let's call it. All right, so that's your basic starter method for making hot water. Now, let's move on to something a little bigger. So I can run that with a 400 watt inverter. Let's say you have an 800 watt inverter or even a 700 watt inverter. Well, then you can move up to a kettle. And the type of kettle that I still use and have used in the past, it's just a random Chinese knockoff brand or Chinese brand. If you've ever seen these Japanese style, I call them, because I first saw them in Japan years ago, kettles, everything connects right to that platform. This one's kind of neat because when you flick the switch up, it turns on and then it automatically pops off when it's done. And inside of here, I've got considerably more water than I can heat in that cup. And I've got 700 watts of heating element. So this does a great job of heating roughly twice as much water as I can do with the immersion heater in half the time. But there's a trade-off. This takes about 700 watts. So let's see how much current it's, or how much power it uses. And we'll get back. These come in different sizes, by the way. So you can get a bigger one. I just chose, it's about the size of my head, because I have a big head. But I chose this little one because it's easier to load in the van, and I'm in a minivan. If you're in a full-size RV, you could go with a larger unit. And these come in like 1,500-watt versions, which will heat 36 ounces of water pretty fast. But on a 700-watt inverter or even a 1,000-watt inverter, you're not going to be able to run that big unit. So I found, I went and looked around and tried to find some that were small enough that you could run them with a reasonable amount of power. So let's see what a reasonable amount of power is on its base. Now this thing's rated at 700 watts, and it'll actually shut off once the water reaches boiling temperature, which is kind of a neat feature. Speaking of boiling temperature and water, I've got water inside of everything I'm testing. A lot of these things you don't want to run dry. Probably wouldn't hurt the crock pot, but you definitely don't want to run the kettle dry. So there's a little water in there just for load. And I'll go ahead and turn it on. That little switch pops back up after it's done boiling. And here I'm pulling 6 amps, 6.5 amps. Go over to wattage. Why do the math? It's pulling 670 watts, basically. So pretty close to its rated power. So that's a kettle style water heater. Like I said, you can get a bigger version than I'm using, but that'll allow you to heat both your water for your oatmeal and your water for your coffee at the same time, and then just pour it on whatever you're doing. It's also bigger inside. So if you want to cook an egg in a bag or whatnot, you can get the water up to boiling and then unplug it, drop your bag in there. I've never tried it with the bag with it still on because I think it might melt the plastic. But anyway, I'm not going to get into what chemicals might leach out of a Ziploc bag. That's for you to worry about. I'm just telling you what I've done in the past, so don't lecture me. All right, so now I have hot water. Well, what am I going to do with it? Currently, I'm using an AeroPress, and I should probably say I'm going to put links for all this in, down below, but I don't know that I can. I haven't actually checked yet because a lot of the stuff might not, the exact model might not still be available. And when I talk about price, those prices are from pre, how shall we put this delicately? pre-2021, and so prices were a little lower on a lot of the stuff. My immersion heater, I think originally cost me in 2017 like $9, and last time I checked, they were about 12, which means they're probably 15 now. The kettle was $18. The AeroPress was a gift from my daughter, so I don't know exactly how much these cost, but this is a nice tiny one, and comes with everything you need to make either espresso, kind of, or coffee. So if you've never seen one of these before, it comes with a spoon, coffee measure, a stirrer, and basically you use these little filters in the bottom. So there's a little hard to see on the video, but it's just a paper filter and inside of its storage. And those go into the bottom here. That locks down. And then you have a plunger. Put your coffee in there. Set it on top of the cup. Pour the hot water over it, and then after a couple minutes, you press it down, just like a French press, except this gives you a little more leverage and a little more power to push it through a filter, so you don't get the silt you get in a French press. Some people prefer a French press, that's fine. I almost use this exclusively now. It works so well. And when you're done, all you're left with is a little piece of paper, which can go in your fire pit outside or throw it in the trash, and kind of a hockey puck of coffee grounds. And those are biodegradable, so you can toss them, you know, off a path someplace and somewhere where they will biodegrade. No one's going to step on them. Generally, I just throw mine in the fire pit and it burns up. All right, so AeroPress. You can also go with a French press. So I've got this nice, I call it a two-person French press. It's 24 ounces. And it was made by a brand called Secura, S-E-C-U-R-A. And it's insulated. So when you put your water in there, it keeps it hot while the French press is going. I'm assuming everyone knows how to do a French press, but you put your coffee in there, pour the hot water on it, set this on top, put the cover down, let it set 5 to 7 minutes, depending on how you like it, and then press it down. Holds all the grounds in the bottom, pour it out. Okay. That is a French press. So I'll occasionally, depending on what the scenario is, if I'm planning on meeting up with people or somebody else, I'll bring the bigger French press because I can make more coffee faster with it. And then if you're just by yourself, this little gadget is made by Bodum, popular brand, easy to find. I think it was about $22. It's an insulated cup, but it also has a built-in French press that you can use or not use. You can just put your coffee in there if you want. And it came with two covers. I have no idea what the standard cover is, but came with two. And then you've got your French press on the top. The other cover just doesn't have a press on it. And it has a nice sealable lid on it. So depending on what your scenario is, those are the things that you can use to make your coffee using just hot water. Okay, so now let's move on to something a little bit more sophisticated, I guess. I don't know if I'd say sophisticated, but a different way of cooking. And that is the slow cooker or crock pot. Now, I'm always going to assume that you've never seen one before, although I'm pretty sure everyone's seen a crock pot. Basically, there's a heating element on the bottom and a crock that comes out that's washable. Talk about the cover. And it cooks at a lower temperature for a longer period of time. Now, I've used these for a number of different things. I used it at last year's meetup with some people down in Quartzsite, and I made some dip in it. So I made some buffalo chicken dip, let it cook in there all day until it was nice and hot. And these draw relatively low amount of power. They're usually under 120 watts. In some cases, the bigger ones will go up to like 180 watts, but you can run them on a smaller inverter. So if you've got that 400-watt inverter, or even if you've got a 200-watt inverter, you could run the slow cooker. So typically what I'll do is, if I'm driving, I'll throw something in after I'm done eating lunch, and it'll be ready for dinner. You know, it'll sit in there for 4 hours. And plus, when I'm driving, my system's charging, so it's not a parasitic loss, or it's at least not running down my battery. I'll give you a pro tip on these. Buy these Reynolds slow cooker liners. And depending on the size pot you have, this one's a 2-quart, this one will fit 1 to 3 quarts. And why these things are great, it's just a plastic bag, but it's Teflon or something. So you put it in your slow cooker, put all your stuff in there, and then when you're done, you grab that bag, pull it out, wad it up, put it in your trash, and cleanup is done. So why does that matter? Well, you might not mind doing dishes. I do. I use a lot of paper plates and whatnot, but one of the big advantages of doing it that way is that if I want to make, let's say, a loaf of bread, and then I want to heat up some soup, I don't have to go through the cleaning process. I don't have to stop for any length of time. And also, I'm not using my onboard water supply. So really, it all comes down to water usage. So these are pretty great. And I mentioned bread. There's a recipe on my website that I use, slow cooker bread. You can find a bunch of them out there. There are as many recipes for crock pots as there are crock pots in the world. You can make just about anything. Now in the crock pot, we've got a little different situation because we've actually got three different heat settings. So we'll try it first on low and see what we get there. Turn on my power. Go to low and give it a second. And then pulling half an amp. Now remember, we're pulling half an amp, but this is at 120 volts. So the power is 52 watts. All right, so I'll turn it up to high. Let's see what it does. And here we're pulling about 90 watts, roughly. It's probably what it's set for, but it's coming in at, or designed for. It's coming in at about 88 watts. And then over to warm. And we're pulling 36. So basically, it's probably designed for 30, then 60, maybe 50, okay. And then 90. So even running this flat out, you're only pulling 90 watts. So relatively little power. And at 120 volts, we're pulling 0.8 amps. So not a lot of load, and that's why I like these slow cookers so much. So a popular option nowadays is a, what do they call the Instapot, because they can brown meat and whatnot. And, you know, if that's what you like, then use one. What I don't like about them is the cleanup. They're a little more work to get clean, a little water required. Someone's going to say, oh, I just wiped mine out. But if you want to do it right, it takes a little while to clean up. All right, so moving on. Over on the right side, I have something I haven't talked about yet. First, let me recap. Low wattage, under 400 watts, you can run an immersion heater. 700 watts, you can run the kettle. 200 watts, you can run a crock pot. But I've got 1,000 watts, so I started thinking about what's the most efficient way for me to cook everything and not use an open flame. And what I came up with is an induction cooktop. So some of you may have them at home, or if you're in a van, you may not have never seen one. I'm puzzled as to why these are not standard equipment on RVs. And the reason is you don't need propane to run them. They're very efficient, and most RVs now have a pretty good battery bank and a lot of people that are boondocking or running solar. And this particular model, I'm not advocating New Wave, although this has been working fine for a year. But what you want to watch for is if it has a variable watt setting. So that's how many watts it's going to pull out of your system. And you'll notice this one has a peak of 1300, which is too high for my system. I've only got a 1,000-watt inverter, so I have to step this down to 900. So what's the difference? Can you reach the same temperature? Can you do the same thing? Yes, it just takes a little bit longer to heat up. So the higher the water setting, the more it has available to heat either the water or cook the food, but it can still reach the high temperatures. And the temperatures are set either by these default settings down here or a combination of the default settings and the plus and minus buttons. And then if you go to max sear, it'll just put it on the highest temperature it can reach, which seems to be around 550 from what I've measured. Now, the feature that I mentioned earlier that this one has that not everyone has is the ability to change the watts. So there are three settings. There's 600, 900, and 1300. And I would say it draws at times on an inrush current about 50 watts more. So it's really 650, 950, 1350 would be my guess. Let's say you have a 700 watt inverter. Well, there's a 600 watt setting. And for mine, I've got a 1,000 watt inverter, so I can use the 900 watt setting. So what's the difference between the settings? Well, the temperature is programmable, which I find, being, you know, not an expert chef, I find it really handy to be able to dial in a temperature and then every day get the same temperature. So when I cook eggs, you know, 270 if I'm doing scrambled eggs, 300 if I'm going to fry a couple eggs up, I'll get repeatable results every time. When I change the wattage, the only difference is it takes longer to get up to that temperature. So where it may take 2 minutes at 1300 watts to heat up to 300 degrees, it'll take a couple more minutes to heat up at 600 degrees. So, you know, where are you going? You're out camping, you know, who cares if it takes a few more minutes, but I figured I should tell you that. So this one also has a programmable time function, and then it has preset temperatures, and then use the plus and minus buttons to set the exact temperature you want. you want to pause it in the middle, you hit the pause button. If you remove the pan, it automatically pauses. It'll stop its thing. When you plug these in and turn them on, put a pan on, it does make a little bit of noise. It's a cooling fan, and you might hear a little hum from it, because the way it works is it's got a magnetic, it's got a coil inside that induces a magnetic field into the iron pan, which causes the molecules to vibrate, and the friction from that heats up the pan. So that's basically how they function. If someone knows more about them, they can correct me in the comments. It also has a sear setting. So if you want to go right to max heat, put it on sear, let it set for a couple of minutes, and then you can throw a hunk of meat in there and it'll put a nice sear on it before you finish cooking it. So those are all the things you can do with this little induction cooktop. And I think every RV should come with these, especially if they have a solar kit and you can run indefinitely. You don't need to haul fuel around with you. In the case of a larger RV, you don't have to use as much propane. And your air conditioning and your heater, your stove, are not fighting each other out in, you know, the heat of the summer, where one's warming up the RV and the other's trying to cool it down. It's just dumb. So but if I had to recommend this for one reason, it would be the precise setting of temperature. With this, you can get a feel for it, but you're burning a lot of food, or you're undercooking it, or it takes a little bit of practice to use this. Here, you can take the recommended settings in the manual, cook different things. And like I said, I'm not a chef, so it worked great for me. So let's get it over here and figure out how much power it uses. So I'm set for 900 watts. I've got it set for 275. If you want to boil water quickly, you can actually set it to a higher temperature. And since you'll hear it boiling and you'll hear it whistling, it doesn't really matter that you have it set for a higher temperature. Let's go for 425. But if you're cooking something like cooking the eggs, around 270 seems to work pretty well in a frying pan, just to give you a place to start with. And it'll go up to that temperature and it'll hold that temperature. It won't go any higher. Here, it's going to go up to that temperature, but it'll never really be able to reach it until it gets the water boiling. So, all right, so that's the basic. Once everything's set, then you just hit the start button, and you're going to hear a fan start. And now it's putting heat into that kettle. So if I come over to here, what am I drawing? I'm drawing 9 amps. Pretty substantial at 120 volts. So wattage. Right about 900. Seems to be staying right around that level. And what you're probably seeing when it changes is it's, as it warms up, it cycles off, cycles down and up to kind of warm it. I don't know, I'm not an expert in these induction plates, but that's the way it seems to work. And that's all there is to setting that up. You can also have a time setting if you want to just set something on low to simmer. Remember, nothing actually starts until you hit the start button. And then if I take the kettle off, it'll detect that it's not there and it'll hold. When I put it back on, it'll resume. So if you take your frying pan off and you do a quick stir and then you put it back on, the system will resume where it was. Pretty neat little product for what did I pay? $60, I think, for that. You just have to remember that all of your pans have to be ferrous-based. They have to be iron-based. And usually if you search on, like, Amazon and you say induction cook plate compatible, you'll find the products that are compatible. And then just double-check that they're not made out of aluminum or something. They should work fine. Well, I promised you a cooking demonstration, so I'm going to give that a shot. We'll see how it goes. I haven't practiced it, so we'll see what happens. So the first thing I'll do is I'll turn on the cooktop. I want to check and make sure I'm on 600 or 900 watts. I'm going to use 600. I might as well show you the slowest cook to give you an idea of how they work, rather than put it on 900 and cook it faster. And so I'll set that for 600, and that's the one thing you have to watch. You'll throw your breaker or blow a fuse if you select too high of a wattage for your inverter. So I always check that, and then I'm going to go ahead and hit start. And I'm going to select medium, which is 275 degrees. Works pretty good for scrambled eggs. Let's just make sure that's centered in there. There's going to be a little background noise in the video because it does have a fan. It does make a little noise. Hopefully sound is still good enough. While that's heating up, I wanted to mention that I did use an amp probe when I measured the current and the power just to make sure that my kilowatt was accurate. So the numbers I gave you should be accurate within the 5% tolerance of this device. All right. So I don't normally carry this when camping, but they're nice to have when you're grilling. This is a infrared temperature probe. So I'm going to measure the surface of the pan. And it's heating up. We're at about 170 degrees right now. I'm going to use, while that's heating, I'm going to use my iPhone to take a video because I want to do this in real time and show you it actually cooking. And where my camera's positioned, you're not really going to be able to see that well. So I'll use two cameras, roll some B-roll. I'm not a professional videographer, so as you probably figured out, so I'm going to do it my way. But anyway, check it. Yeah, we're getting up there. We're at 250, so we're pretty much ready to cook. I pre-mixed a scrambled egg with some milk and some kitchen pepper. And I'm going to throw that into the griddle in a second as soon as I get my camera ready. I'll explain what kitchen pepper is while it's cooking if you don't know. Get my camera ready. Rather than professionalism, I strive to do a complete lack of professionalism. All right, so I've got my video going here and going to go ahead and pour the egg in. You can see it already bubbling in there. And then I'll just kind of stir it around. Again, this is at 275. And you'll be able to see in the B-roll how quick it cooks. Now, I love these non-stick pans because I can clean them up with a paper towel. Sometimes a little bit of water on the paper towel if it gets really grimy. But they're really super easy to clean. And I use a silicone spatula so I don't scratch up the pan. Yeah, we're getting there. It's almost breakfast here. So when you cook scrambled eggs, you, I'm sure, have your own way of doing it. I generally use a little bit of milk. I'll either put a savory spice in or I'll put a more sweet spice like I'm using right now. All right, we're getting there. And occasionally a little pat of butter. It's not necessary with these pans. And I don't need the extra calories, that's for sure. Flip that over, and they're pretty much done at this point. So I'll flip it up toward the camera. Notice when I take it off, it stops running. And I've got a scrambled egg. And then I'm going to shut that off because I don't need burnt scrambled eggs in my garage. All right, take one more temperature reading of the pan just for the hell of it. It's saying I'm getting a little steam there. 260, it's cooling off fast, 240. So it does cool down pretty quick. And you might want your eggs done a little more than that, but I think these are pretty well done. So I mentioned earlier kitchen pepper. So I got this recipe from Townsend. If you've ever watched his cooking channel, Colonial Foods. And this goes back to colonial times. It's salt, pepper, nutmeg, which gives it a key flavor. And I think it also might have ginger. It has ginger. Might be a pinch of cinnamon, if I remember right. So it's really good for scrambled eggs. It gives them kind of, how would I describe it, like almost a custardy flavor, like a French toast flavor. But there's a little bit of salt in there, which, makes an egg taste better. You can leave the salt out if you're salt sensitive. I'll try to remember to put a link at the bottom in the video description on Townsend's channel and on how to make kitchen pepper. But what's great about this stuff, if you don't have an aversion to nutmeg, is that it works great on chicken. It works awesome on pork chops. If you want to cook a pork chop in the pan here, works for eggs. It's just like a universal spice when you're traveling, and if you're cooking for someone else when you're camping, it's a little something extra that they didn't expect when you make breakfast. So I hope this video was helpful. I'm going to try to get out a couple more in the next couple of months. And If any of you are going out to Quartzsite this year, I'll be out there in the long-term vacation area south. What is it? What do they call that? Laposa South or something? But anyway, just south of Quartzsite. And there's a bunch of us, a lot of YouTube guys are getting together. And, you know, who doesn't have a channel these days? And we're kind of camping together. It's a good fellowship. So if anybody's interested in that, drop me a note and I will tell you where we are. I'm actually going to do an on-the-spot cooking demo with the induction plate, more for people that are traveling in larger RVs rather than the van community. But there'll probably be some vanners there, and there's going to be at least one minivan there. So that's all I've got for today. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I guess I'll add one more thing to the end of this for people that have watched the channel for a long time. You're probably noticing, hey, this garage looks different than the last garage he was in. I did a short video when I was living in Massachusetts. So in the last couple of years, I went from selling my house in Michigan to moving to Rockport, Massachusetts. Spent fall, winter, spring there, right in the water, 2 blocks from the ocean. It was great. Then Central Mass, where I grew up. And then we decided we were going to move back to Michigan. So we came back this way, and now I'm in Central Michigan. So new place, little more workspace, as you can see. I'm working on some projects in the van, infrared lights, basically to cast infrared light all around the vehicle at night. And I have cameras. I won't point out, for obvious reasons, where the cameras are, but I can see 360 degrees now at night, which is kind of nice if you're in sketchy neighborhoods and whatnot. If you're out in the woods, I don't. It's nice to not know that there's a bear outside, but if you're going to go outside in the middle of the night or something. I've also added hinges to my solar panel, and I'm experimenting with props, prop rods. Right now, I've just got some strap because that's what I had. In my opinion, it's not a good long-term solution, but I'm going to use it when I go out to Quartzsite so I can tilt my panel, and then I optimize the angle of the panel. If you follow me on Instagram, then you'll see more frequent updates than you do on the YouTube channel. No reason for that other than it's easy to do a quick Insta where it takes a lot of time for me to do a YouTube video. The other thing is YouTube demonetized me, bastards. But it was my own fault. And it wasn't over anything I said, which is amazing. But it was because they had sent out an email. Now, this is the irony of it. They sent this email out saying there are new terms and conditions, and if you don't manually go in and accept them, then we'll demonetize your, you know, whatever. So I didn't get the email, and I used Gmail for my email that my YouTube info goes to, and Gmail filtered it out and put it in the spam filter. I don't have any pre-existing filters. I tried to catch everything, but it sorted it as junk, and I never got their message, so they demonetized me. Now, I just find it's funny because it's not like I'm making my living off of YouTube. And in the last video, and actually in this one, the intro that I put in it uses copyrighted soundtrack from Space 1999, if you didn't figure that out already. It's kind of the reference of the intro to the video. Because of that, I can't collect money on this anyway. So if you wanted to help, and it's not necessary, you can use the links below. They're affiliate links for Amazon. But I say check Amazon prices, check your local prices, depending on where you live and what your local taxes are, or I guess Amazon collects taxes in most states now. You might find a better deal at Walmart. So I'm not saying buy the exact ones I have. Crockpot, there's a ton of them out there, and you can get them for about $15 in a store. Amazon is more convenient, so I use them for a lot of things. And some people may not have a discount store that carries all this stuff near them, so that's why I put the Amazon links up. It doesn't cost you a penny more, but I make like 5 cents on a sale or whatever. Pays for gas money, let's put it that way. All right, that's all I've got for this time around, and I hope to run out to you on the road. Drive safe. So one of the questions I had about these new wave pick flex induction plates is, when I change the input wattage, in other words, the power draw, does it affect the temperature it can reach, and does it affect how long it takes to reach it? I suspect the latter, but I'm going to test it. So I've got my handy dandy infrared temperature probe. Says it's 45 degrees, which feels about right for the garage right now. And I've got my spare iPhone as a timer. So let me set up a little test and see how long it takes to get to 425 on 600 watts. Then we'll do it again for 900 and 1300 watts. When you first get one of these induction plates, one thing that you'll probably do if you're anything like me is you'll hit the button for the temperature you want and then forget to hit the start. You have to hit start in order for it to start heating the plate. All right, so let's hit start on the timer, start on the hot plate, and then I'll just kind of check the temperature as I go through here. Up to 88, 89, 90. Okay. Once it gets a little warmer, I'll go ahead and hit the temperature probe again. All right, let's give it about a minute. Can't wait a minute. All right, we're up to 200. So I think if you put, let's say you threw like 3 scrambled eggs in that pan, it's going to take a little longer to heat them, I believe, on the lower wattage. But let's prove that out just by seeing how long it takes to reach temperature. Now, when I run this, I run it on the 900 watt setting. I've got a 1000 watt inverter, so I suspect it'll go a lot faster, but I figured why not start with 600 and see how it does there. Maybe I should reverse the video and start with a higher wattage, make the induction plate look awesome, and then go down to the lower wattage. Okay, we're about 300 degrees. Based on working at 900 watts, I think it's a lot slower at 600. But hey, if you've only got a 700 watt inverter, then this might be the way to go, the lower setting. Now, if I were to put a cast iron pan on top of propane, it would probably take a similar amount of time to stabilize, probably 2 to 3 minutes before it was up to temperature. So something to think about. Rough rule of thumb, I'm thinking 100 degrees per minute. Get up to 425. Now I'm using 425, I'm using a high setting just to basically show the upper limit. Of course, most things you're gonna cook, eggs or cook a burger or whatnot, you probably do it at a lower temperature, but 425, let's make it the same test for every setting. So I'm going to take this pan, I'm going to garage floor, which is 45 degrees, cool it off, let the induction plate cool down, and then we'll try it again at the 900 watt setting. Okay, test 2.
set at 900 watts on the input side. Temperature 46 degrees. That's about as scientific as it's going to get in the garage. And let's get the timer going and hit the start button. Nope, should probably set it for 425. There we go. All right, start. Start. Sure it's centered. And I'll check it at 1 minute. Go from there. All right, at 1 minute, we're at 306 degrees. So I believe it's definitely getting hotter faster at the higher wattage, which makes sense. And just for the record, I am plugged into wall current to remove the variability of the power supply in my van. I go back and cook with the power supply in my van. But for now, for this test, I want to have the same exact voltage going in, same exact current available. 350, 374, 381. Okay. We're probably going to hit it at 2 minutes, so half the time. Yeah, I can smell it getting hot. Whoa. Okay. We made it. Actually, I overshot it a little bit. About 2 minutes and 20 seconds. So 900 watts definitely gives you a lot better performance. Now you can see why induction is superior. If I put this plate on top of a propane or even a natural gas burner and ran it full blast, I probably wouldn't hit 425 in 2 minutes. Just saying, might be possible, but now you're starting to see the efficiency. So for those of you with 2,000 watt inverters, I only have a 1,000 watt, but at 2,000 watts, you could run it at the 1,300 watt setting. So let's cool this down and see what it does at 1,300 watts.